Okay, in this video, I'm going to look at Lamini LM, a diverse herd of distilled models from large-scale instructions. So this is based on a paper, but they've also released a code for this, and they've released a data set for this. I will preface this video at the start that if you're just here to find out if this is the latest, best large language model, this is not the latest, best large language model. In fact, all these models are very tiny by design. And so if you're just here for that, this is probably not the video for you, okay? But this is a super interesting paper and a super interesting project. So I definitely want to sort of cover it and have a look at some of the things that they raise. And then also we'll have a look at the models and we'll have a look at, you know, some of the code and stuff behind it as well. So the key idea here is that what they're basically trying out is that, okay, what happens if you go for a really small model but you use a lot more scaled instructions? So if you think back to Alpaca, Alpaca only had like 52,000 instructions. The base model Llama was a very large model. That was a 7 billion parameter model. But the number of instructions for Alpaca itself were actually very small. So the idea here is to do the inverse of that, of go for a small model, but with a lot of distilled instructions. So, okay, what are they actually doing here? If we look at this diagram, we can sort of see that they're basically, they've got some seed instructions. They then use a GPT 3.5 Turbo API to generate synthetic instructions and add those, and then they generate synthetic responses to these. And their data set gets really big. So they've released the data set here, and they've gone right up to sort of 2.58 million pairs of instructions and responses for this. Now, they've used the Alpaca data set, they've used the self-instruct data set, they've used P3, they've used the original FLAN data set as all sort of ways to generate more instructions. And if we have a look, we can see that, you know, they've actually released the data set on Hugging Face. So if you wanted to actually come down and train your own big model, this is something that you certainly can do. So here they point out, they give some little bit info about it. Then they show that they've actually trained a lot of models here. So we can see that they've trained quite a few FLAN T5, the Cerebrus models, which I did a video about, even things like GPT-2, which is kind of insane because that model is like super old now. They've gone back and trained up, you know, versions of that that use these instructions. And this is one of the models that we're going to look at in here. And they've also got other models on the way. So the GPT-J and the Llama models, I guess, are training. Those are definitely going to take, you know, for the Llama models, are going to take quite a while to train with this 2.5 million data set that they've got here. So let's just jump into the paper and have a look at what's going on here and see what they're doing. So they've got the same diagram as what they've got in GitHub here, but here we obviously go into a lot more detail. So they're sort of proposing this idea of if you went for a smaller model, but a much larger data set for the fine tuning of this. And so they look at what's sort of out there. They talk a bit about the Alpacas, all the models that have come after that with the, in the 7 to 13 billion range. And they propose that they're going to go for, you know, models that are much smaller than that. So here they basically talk about that they're going to go for a data set size of 2.58 million instructions. And this is a large part of what the paper is about. The fine-tuning of models and stuff is interesting, and their evaluation is also interesting. But really, it's about how did they make this data set? Because I think there are a lot of lessons that we can take away from this ourselves to make data sets for ourselves. They tell us that this was made using the GPT 3.5 Turbo, and the idea is this is going to generate supplementary instructions. And they talk about there are two types of instructions that they use. The example-guided instruction generation and topic-guided instruction generation. So the cool thing in here is they've got quite good descriptions of what they do. They even give you the prompts for this. And I threw this into ChatGPT, and we can have a look at actually how does this go. So you can see here that they provide three examples, and they put example tags around these. And then they basically say, generate 20 diverse examples. So this is the first way of generation. This is basically just generating more examples based on giving it some examples. And here they're just saying, generate 20 diverse examples that are similar to the provided examples. You do not need to provide a response to the generated examples. Each example must include an instruction. Each generated instruction can either be an imperative sentence or a question. And then it basically tells us, you know, how it's going to export it with these tags. And sure enough, you can see if we drop that into ChatGPT, it generates out examples quite well with this. So that's the first generation that they do. This was the example-guided instruction generation that they've got in there. The second kind of generation that they've got in here is the topic-guided instruction generation. So here they've got a really nice idea. What they do is they go to Wikipedia and they collect topics from Wikipedia. So first off, Wikipedia has 2.2 million topics. But what they do is they filter these based on a number of different requirements. So first off, the topic must have less than 3 words. They make the point that if it has less than 3 words, it's generally going to be a more sort of general topic that will have subtopics. And that's one of the things that they want, is they want it to have at least more than 10 subcategories or subtopics in there and 50 pages of information so that they know that this is really not just a niche thing, this is a proper category in this. Once they go and do that filtering, you can see that they end up with 3,500 categories that serve as common topics. They then basically use a prompt to generate examples based on these kind of topics. So if we go back and look at the next example in ChatGPT, we can see that this is using some examples like before, but now it is now giving it actual topics. And here we can see the topics are, you know, these design bureaus, we've got infantry. So this is the idea here, is that it will now generate examples based on these particular topics. And you can see, sure enough, it does. We can see straight away, what are the key factors to consider when choosing a design bureau for your project? Have design bureaus evolved over the past decade? We see like a whole bunch of different things. What are some of the most interesting characteristics of infantry soldiers? So this is getting examples that are on topic for this. They then basically use the GPT 3.5 Turbo API to generate responses. They then cluster those to see, okay, how do these compare in diversity compared to the original data sets? And you can see here, they've basically got some diagrams of them doing the clustering. After that, they go on to basically train up some models and run them on a set of downstream tasks. And so they've got some really interesting ideas here of that they're comparing not only similar kinds of decoder models or GPT models, they also compare it to the FLAN models, the T5 models, the encoder decoder models. And so they've got some, you know, interesting points here about what they found, you know, which kinds of models outperform other models. So they talk about the encoder decoder, the mini language models outperform the decoder models when things are roughly the same parameter size in there. They make, you know, a really amazing statement that this Lemini FLAN T5 248 even outperforms Llama 7 billion on downstream NLP tasks. So that would be the Llama that's not been fine-tuned, obviously. So obviously this fine-tuning of the FLAN is doing better than the raw Llama model there. They also basically point out, you know, some things about the GPT, what they're calling the Lemini GPT, which is the GPT-2 model, and they compare them to the Cerebus models. It turns out that, sure enough, just as we looked at when we looked at the Cerebus models in the video, that probably those models weren't that great as base models for this kind of thing. And that surprisingly, GPT-2 seems to have done better than some of those. Can we see, you know, generally vanilla GPT Two also performs Cerebrus GPT models of comparable size on downstream tasks. So let's jump into the code and have a look at what these actually have. So like I mentioned earlier on, they've released the data set. They've also released a set of different models on the Hugging Face Hub. So we've got some T5s going from tiny little models of 61 million, right up to the biggest model in here is only the GPT-2 model, which is 1.5 billion model, which is very small compared to what we've been looking at recently. So I basically decided to pick three of these models to try out. I've gone for the FLAN T5, the GPT-2 model, and the Neo model. So if we jump in and have a look at this, the first one I've got here is the Neo model. And we've just got some simple code for doing this. This is a decoder-only model. So we've got the causal language modeling, bringing it in, and we're just bringing a pipeline of text generation. And I've just written some little code to sort of just tidy up the responses as it comes out of the model. And you can see that, okay, first off, we can ask it the general sort of questions that we've been asking it. What are the differences between alpacas, vicunas, and llamas? And you'll see that it's able to give us some information. Now, I'm not going to say that this is as good as the 7 billion models. Far from it, right? This is 1.3 billion parameters that we're looking at here. So it's the fact that it's even able to just stay on topic and stuff like that is already a win for some of these. What is the capital of England? London. Write a short note to Sam Altman. So this one actually does a pretty decent shot at doing this, much better than you'll see than some of the other models that we look at later on. It's definitely getting some facts and some phrasing off, though, when we look at this. Of course, because this has been trained on a distilled data set, we're going to get the AI language model stuff in here. Unfortunately, for some of these, you'll see that it tends to hallucinate about some of these things. I've done this one twice. First time, it didn't do very well. Second time, it did a lot better. So it is interesting that I probably don't see that as an AI language model as much as I see it in the Alpaca or in the Vicuna models, etc. My guess is probably just because of the diversity of the data set and the size of the data set means that it doesn't see this as often as those other models see it. Let's jump into the next one and just have a look at this one. So this is the GPT 1.5 billion Lamini. And so this is technically the GPT-2 model that we've got in here. Same code, etc. for running this. We can see that this is giving us responses. Again, not kind of bad. This is a little bit bigger than the Neo one, but I'm pretty sure the Neo is trained on more tokens than GPT-2. It's able to get some of these right. It didn't do a great job at this. Write a short note to Sam Altman giving reasons to open source GPT-4. A number of times when I ran this, it just said noted, or it said, okay, I will do that kind of thing. Here it's sort of saying to open source GPT-4, I recommend giving it a try as it has potential benefits for your team's development efforts. You can see that the responses in here are pretty good. We would not have expected this maybe from a GPT, something like a dialogue GPT or something like that, that was based on GPT-2 in the past for these. The final one that I look at is the FLAN T5 one. So this is actually half the size of the previous one. Now, this is a sequence-to-sequence model. Obviously, it's an encoder-decoder model for the T5 model. So we need to use the auto model for sequence-to-sequence LMs in there, and we need to change this to text-to-text generation. Also, I changed a little bit. They seem to have changed the generation out from this a little bit. So I've changed the filtering function there. Okay, we can see what are the differences between alpacas, vicunas, and llamas. Doesn't give us a great answer, but it's definitely on topic here. So you could imagine that we're doing a sort of general model here, which is not how you would use these things. These things are more for where you would basically hone in on one domain and train it up on a lot of data for that one particular domain and get it going for that. So that's something to think about. What is the capital of England? The capital of England is London. Write a short note to Sam Altman giving reasons to open source GPT-4. And then it's sort of done something around it. We're definitely not getting the, in-depth responses that we get from a Vicuna 13 billion or something. But we're talking about something that's 20 times smaller. So it's not surprising in this case. Asking it about Homer. So first off, it basically does the whole, as an AI, I don't have the ability to like or dislike things. However, I'm knowledgeable about Homer. But it's quite sassy that it's not going to tell us what it knows about Homer. So I ask it again, and then here it gets, oh yeah, Homer is a character on TV show Simpsons who is known for his intelligence. I'm not sure that is correct. A humor and willingness to help those in need. Again, not sure about that. So you can see just different responses of that it gets out for those things. None of them did well on the reasoning questions. You know, if we sort of look at these, I think it's the reasoning one here. It's basically saying that you would have 16 apples left. Not accurate. Although it does get the bit about a haiku that, yes, that could be in a single tweet. For the Neo model, again, it doesn't do a good job with the reasoning on the apples, but it does an okay job at the haiku thing. So this one also, again, not a great job at counting, at working out those sorts of things. But it does know a little bit about haikus in this case. So anyway, the goal here is not that these are going to replace your general purpose vicuna or your koala model or something like that. The goal here is that these are showing that if you train with a lot more data, even a small model can get decent results with this kind of thing. So you've got to think that as they bring out the 7 billion models, and if they do them, the 13 and 30 billion models on this 250 million data set, it's going to be interesting to see how they compare to the full vicuna models or the stable vicuna, those sorts of models. Anyway, as always, if you've got questions, please put them in the comments. If you found this useful, please click like and subscribe. I will talk to you in the next video. Bye for now.